two men like that could scarcely have been more different. And yet one Ash Wednesday evening, the both of them stood in the same sanctuary in the First Baptist Church of Somersville. They didn't arrive at the same time, and certainly not together. Not even close on either count. Thurston was one of the first ones there. He made sure. Dressed in an immaculate three-piece suit, he strolled to the second pew, sat near the center aisle. It was a couple pews in advance of where most folks felt comfortable sitting. There was plenty of room in that big sanctuary, though. Everybody knew Thurston. Thurston sat on the borough council. Thurston was a board member here at First Baptist. If you needed help, you turned to Thurston. Thurston wouldn't let you down. See, Thurston went above and beyond the call of duty. Thurston budgeted ample resources for generosity of all kinds. Every Sunday morning, you could faithfully hear the offering plate go clink when it came by Thurston. Same for every special offering. Half of what went into the plate at the back of the sanctuary fell out of Thurston's hand. Above and beyond, always Thurston's motto. He knew the Bible backward and forward, up and down. He celebrated every holy day with exacting precision. Thurston ran a successful business, gave his employees their Christmas bonuses without fail. Thurston was articulate. He volunteered to preach whenever the pastor went on vacation, and half the congregation sometimes wished the pastor wouldn't come back so they could keep Thurston in that hole. He was a fountainhead of moral advice. He avoided all the class advices scrupulously. He never smoked. He never drank. He never gambled. He never danced. Hey, it was a Baptist church, come on. He was faithful and supportive of his lovely wife, and everybody knew Thurston. A man without scandal, trustworthy and true, a role model to the entire church. Thurston was a real stand-up guy. So Thurston stood up. And Thurston prayed. The words flowed off Thurston's tongue. Almighty and everlasting God, I thank thee most highly and most heartily that thou hast seen fit to bless me in multitudinous ways. Thou hast prospered me and thou hast extended my borders. I thank thee, O Lord most high, that thou hast made me who I am, for surely I could have been raised differently. I could have had a weaker character. I could have had less opportunity. I could have taken less initiative. But God, my God, I am not like other men. Those who disappoint thee or disobey thee. O God, I am not unrighteous. O God, I am not an adulterer. O God, I am not a thief. O God, I am not a murderer or gangster or ne'er-do-well. O God, I dress so finely. O God, I am not a drunkard, nor a smoker, nor a gambler, nor an addict. I stand for thy values. I write letters to my congressman. I quote thy words to him. Thy favor is upon me. As all my dealings and all my prosperity doth abundantly attest, O God of heaven. And so I thank thee, O God, that I am not like those many other men. Weaklings, reprobates, hypocrites, judgmental, militant, bigoted, promiscuous, greedy, bankrupt, rapacious, traitorous, and unreliable, I am not like them. I thank thee especially, O God, that I am not like him. Prayed Thurston, noticing out the corner of his eye a bedraggled figure crept sheepishly toward the back pew. For I, O God, pray 3, 4, 5 times a day, and I, O God, hold vigils to take America back in thy name, and I, O God, never fall short of a full tithe. I am chaste, I am truthful, I am virtuous, I am a man after your own heart. Whatever thou hast asked for in thy word, I render it double unto thee. And so, almighty and everlasting God, this is my confession. I thank thee in advance for another year of reward and plenty. Look down now from thy holy habitation in heaven and bless me as thou art bound by thy promise so to do. Amen. And Thurston sat down. Thurston shares a great deal in common with the story Jesus once told, the story we heard read this morning. You see, Thurston, had he lived in first century Judea, would have been a card-carrying Pharisee. It's easy for us to forget, given the dim view of Pharisaic spirituality that prevails in the Gospels, that to most Jews of the time, the Pharisees were spiritual rock stars. They were superheroes. They avoided all the obvious vices. They had their hearts set on renewing Israel and paving the way for the Messiah through national righteousness. They were a renewal movement. They wanted revival. They scrupulously obeyed the law of Moses. The Pharisee in the parable went above and beyond the law, carrying out acts of piety so intense as if to put God somehow in his own debt. The Pharisees held sin at the greatest distance by building a fence around the law, carefully steering clear of any infractions, and they held themselves out as an example for others to imitate. Thurston would have made a fine Pharisee. In fact, he did. Pharisees were like him, upstanding members of society. The trouble here, you see, is that Thurston's prayer knows nothing of real grace or real mercy. It doesn't glorify God at all. Thurston's prayer glorifies Thurston. Thurston's prayer fits very poorly with Ash Wednesday or with any day of the Christian life. Thurston speaks volumes on his fidelity to the law, his achievements, his fulfillment of the commandments. But those people Thurston distances himself from, he doesn't love them as himself. Isn't that a commandment? And a prayer where Thurston's I, is the main active agent is a prayer that puts him in the center and God in a supporting role. See, Thurston's prayer is all about what he's earned and he's accomplished. Thurston prays for what he insists he deserves. Thurston's religion is business. It's a transaction. He keeps all the thou shalt nots, and in turn God must prosper him, and people must respect and admire him. Thurston looks down on others who don't meet his exacting standards, benignly sometimes, but disdain and judgment all the same. Thurston has a lot going for him. You see, Martin Luther describes his Pharisee forefather as having nothing but beautiful works, such that the Pharisee appears to the world a paragon of godliness, a fine, pious, God-fearing, and holy man. That's what the Pharisee looks like. But Thurston's prayer is self-centered and prideful and loveless. It's not only obnoxious. His prayer is an abomination, a blasphemy. To the astonishment of all who heard Jesus, people like Thurston walk away dirty from the service, stained by sin and in opposition to the heart of the God they claim. Thurston wasn't alone in the sanctuary. See, midway through his prayer, as you may recall, another man entered the sanctuary. Ira didn't have much in common with Thurston. Ira didn't wear a three-piece suit. In most people's opinion, he wasn't dressed for church at all. In his grubby, wrinkled shirt, his hole-ridden jeans riding low beneath a couple inches of underwear hanging out the back, his grimy sneakers trailing mud behind him. Ira dressed the part of a teenager and made him feel young again. And he so desperately wanted to get back to the start. He knew he'd squandered his life. Ira used to attend First Baptist as a kid, but that was then. After quitting the church, he spent some time as a radical activist. Ah, the passions of youth. The feds had a file on him, no doubt. In the years since, he'd rotated through plenty of avocations. Heroin dealer for one. Ira almost didn't come today. Couldn't bear to face church families who'd lost a daughter, a sister, a son, or a brother who was proud of. A loan shark he'd been after for a while after lucking out in a poker tournament, but he blew all that. These days, Ira made a lifestyle out of dodging child support payments and taxes, doing odd jobs around town for under-the-table cash. Thurston was very proud to be nothing like Ira, and Ira couldn't blame him. Ira sat in the far corner of the back pew, closest to the door in case he needed to cut a hasty exit. And that would have been fine with most, because people had learned around town to keep a close eye on their watches and wallets when Ira was near. Ira knew good and well what other people thought of him. He used to be defiant about it, but these past weeks had driven it all home. Ira could hardly stand to look himself in the mirror when he brushed his teeth or shaved, which consequently were tasks he reserved for special occasions. He felt like the bottom had fallen out of his life. If he were here to confess his sins, it would take him from Ash Wednesday till Easter to even tell it happened. And that's just what the drinking hadn't made too fuzzy to recall. So after a week of close calls, Ira was desperate for someone to turn to. But Ira had no friends. Ira couldn't blame him. So here he was, the one place that no one would have expected. Least of all, Ira himself. Ira listened with muffled ears to the close of Thurston's prayer. And he listened in a way Thurston didn't, as the pastor led the Ash Wednesday liturgy. The words seemed to trail in and out of Ira's consciousness. To dust you shall return. I know my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. We have sinned by our own fault in thought, word, and deed. Our self-indulgent appetites and ways and our exploitation of other people. We confess to thee, O Lord. Ira's eyes filled with tears. He had stolen more than he could ever give back, not just in money he had appropriated, not just in evil causes he had supported with a hard heart, but in flesh and blood lives in his community he'd broken and ruined. Ira didn't know his transgressions. His sin really was ever before him. Ira could harbor no illusions about his self-indulgent appetites and ways. And he could bear it no more. Ira thought he was about to burst. As if in a dream, he leapt to his feet, interrupting the litany of penitence. With a downcast gaze and a heavy heart, he pounded his chest with a calloused hand and sobbed the words over and over again, God be mercy on me, on sinner! He broke down, blubbering. It was not a pretty sight to anyone around. The pastor uneasily and unsteadily wrapped up the words of absolution, after which Ira fled. Ira's prayer was obnoxious. It was noisy. It was loud. It was intemperate. It interrupted the service. It lacked all social graces. It came in an ill-dressed and malodorous package. It wasn't eloquent. It was barely English. And it came from the mouth of someone who has no reasonable expectation in himself of getting an answer. All that is true. But where Thurston's prayer was centered on himself, Ira's prayer left Ira as an afterthought. Where Thurston's prayer was bold, confident, and proud, Ira's was humble. Not in the way of our common false modesty, but in real emptiness of self. Where Thurston's prayer was far from the course, Ira's prayer was life or death. And where Thurston prayed for his just reward based on his goodness, I would pray for the mercy of God in spite of his own corruption. Thurston looked in the mirror and saw nothing to repent of. But Ira looked in the mirror when he could and saw nothing else. And as Jesus tells the tale of the tax collector, Ira's spiritual forefather, a traitor to the nation of Israel, a social outcast, was the only one of the two who walked away looking good in God's eyes. If Ira's prayer is an obnoxious one, well, it's exactly the kind of obnoxious prayer God loves. Like Martin Luther once said, we pray, after all, because we are unworthy to pray. And that was Ira's prayer. Thurston's prayer was I-centered. Ira's was I-emptied. For the sake of God's mercy. Pray like Ira. Be obnoxious like Ira. Now, before Jesus set the stage for the Pharisee and the tax collector to come on the scene, he spun another good yarn. Jesus told of a widow who was destitute and desperate, and a judge whose hunger for a bride was keeping him down. The judge didn't have any awe for God, and he respected nobody but himself. The widow came to him. She was being taken advantage of by all her neighbors. She was victimized by crime. She was hounded by the bank. And she made her case to the judge. The judge said, no, go away. The next day, there she was again. The judge said, no, get out of here. And cussed her out. Soon she was appearing everywhere. You just imagine. He goes to the mall. There she is. He eats at the luncheonette. There she shows up. Takes a walk in the park. He finds her there. She shows up outside his house at all hours of day or night. There she must be inconveniencing him. And as his sleep ebbed away, as his patience wore thin, eventually the judge says to himself, I am so sick of this. If giving her justice is what will keep her away, then fine, she can have it. Guess they didn't have restraining orders in those days. But it worked. The widow was so obnoxious in pestering the judge loudly and constantly, day in and day out, that her obnoxious petition prevailed. And Jesus told us this story so that we might always pray and not lose heart. For if even an unjust judge will yield to the obnoxious pestering of a widow who cries out day and night, won't a good God give quick and sudden justice to his chosen children who pray the same way, never losing heart, never giving up hope of being vindicated when Christ grabs the wheel of his car careening out of control? You see, the widow's prayer is certainly obnoxious. It's repetition. It's loud. It's abrasive. It's a nuisance. And then Jesus tells us that God, his Father, is so very responsive to his favorite nuisances, like us. So go ahead and pester your Father. He's never too busy to handle your case, however big or however small. Jesus tells these stories to convince us, to remind us of that. And finally, after treating us to this widow, this Pharisee, this tax collector, we see one last vignette in today's reading. There were some people carrying small children to Jesus. Some were infants. Some were toddlers. Maybe they led a couple elementary school age kids his way just because they wanted these kids to have some contact with this gracious man named Jesus. The disciples saw this and they appointed themselves as the bouncers of the club. And they tried to interfere and block the way. It makes you wonder why. Why would the disciples think it wise to keep these children away from Jesus? Is it because they thought it would be a waste of Jesus' time? Were they concerned it would be a drain on his energy after a long day of preaching? Well, maybe that's in there. But I think there's something else. Here's another reason that might have gone through their minds. Don't bring those kids to Jesus. Kids are obnoxious. Now, don't deny it, it's true. Have you ever spent time with kids that age, kids besides your own or your grandkids, I mean? They don't know how to shut up. And they usually don't have that much that's objectively interesting to tell you. They have no sense of propriety. They'll dress themselves up in all sorts of mismatched ways if you let them. Nobody can follow their flights of fancy. They can be loud, they like to scream, they cry at the drop of a hat, sometimes, literally, if a hat drops on the floor, they might cry. Kids are brash. They say whatever they're thinking, they love to voice their opinions. They maybe love it especially if you tell them to stop. They eat too much and then they throw up all over you. They are, in a word, obnoxious. They're also quick to trust. So Jesus tells the disciples off. He says that these obnoxious brats are no waste of his time. Their obnoxiousness is the stuff God's kingdom is building. And if you want to get in on it, he tells the disciples, you've got to start over from there. Be more like them. Pray more like them. Bold, daring, humble, obnoxious. When I was a daycare teacher for a few years, I'd usually ask some kids to volunteer to lead the daily prayers. I didn't want them to just hear me leading them. I wanted them to have a chance to be priests to one another and to experience for themselves the joys of talking with their God. So I got to let these kids lead me in prayer. I got to eavesdrop on them as they brought their souls before their Maker. They had no God. There was none of the Pharisees' braggadocio. Their prayers could be sweet. Their prayers could be long-winded. They could be grating and tiresome and misplaced. They can be shouted. They were, at their very best, blessedly obnoxious. You see, an obnoxious prayer like the Pharisees' prayer is obnoxious because it's hurtful. It's hurtful to those around them, and it's derogatory toward God's glory. But an obnoxious prayer like the tax collectors, or the widows, or the child's, those are dangerous prayers. They are fierce prayers. They are prayers with all the rawness of wild faith. The kind you catch out in the woods or in the desert. This week the world will be observing the 500th anniversary of the Reformation. A movement that coalesced when one obnoxious monk challenged the domesticated propriety and the prideful self-centeredness he saw all around him in the religion and society of his day. And as that monk stumbled after God's leading, he bade us to strip away the inessentials, to empty our blowhard prayers and our judgments, to admit our thoroughgoing sinfulness, to view ourselves as superior to none, and to lean on nothing else than the mercy of God made near to every sinner in Jesus Christ, the friend of sinners. To cry out for grace alone, through faith alone, to hammer on heaven's door for it, no matter who's listening, is an obnoxious thing. Loud, unseemly, unpolished, impolite, repetitive, pesky. But in no other way can we trade our filthy rags for the righteousness we can't manufacture and manage. In no other way can we gain the humble love through which faith blooms. This week I beg of you, go pray some obnoxious prayers. Amen.